Very warm welcome. Welcome to the course of Remote Sensing and GIS. In this course of Remote Sensing and GIS, which is basically a final year elective course, which actually gives you a brief overview about what are the different remote sensing platforms, what are the different remote sensors which are available, and we will see different kinds of digital image processing techniques and what are the interpretation, how to understand from a satellite image, and next we will also have an integration in the GIS where the remote sensing data is getting used and integrated in the GIS. So a brief overview of the entire remote sensing and GIS you will be getting in this course. So we will have a brief overlook about the curriculum which actually is designed for this remote sensing and GIS, where we will have 5 units. And each of them are having their own characteristics, where the first unit basically talks about your basics of the remote sensing, and next we will see the digital interpretation, image processing, next we will see the digital image processing, next two units talk about the integration in GIS. So let's have a look on the curriculum and understand what is this course of remote sensing and GIS.
Okay, so this remote sensing and GIS, basically if you hear the word remote sensing and GIS, first let me tell you something about remote sensing. The word itself says remote sensing. Sensing an object remotely is exactly the meaning. If you just try to find out the meaning of that, sensing an object remotely is called as remote sensing. And the other word GIS means geographic information system. Okay, so in this course we will be trying to understand out of the 5 units, half of the curriculum is designed for remote sensing and half of that is designed for your GIS. Okay, so GIS also specifically talking, we have n number of softwares for GIS, but we will be discussing about one software which is called as ArcGIS. Okay, so first 3 units, whatever we will be talking, that is about the remote sensing. So you people might be having a doubt, what is this remote sensing, what is this GIS, how civil engineering is into this remote sensing and GIS, right? So remote sensing and GIS has n number of applications. But specifically talking, civil also has so many kinds of applications. For example, if you wanted to move from one place to the other place, let's say today I wanted to travel from Basar to Nizamabad, I didn't actually know how I need to go in that, or which route I should prefer, I don't know. So what simply you will be doing, you will be just opening your Google Maps, right? Yeah. And simply you will keep what is your start point and what is your destination, and just it will be showing you a route map to you. But how exactly that is being designed, or how exactly that route is coming to you, and it will show you if there are 3 routes, which route is taking how much distance, which is the very shortest distance, how much time of travel, how these things have been done. So these are, everything is done by a satellite. You know what is a satellite, right? Satellite is nothing but a kind of spacecraft which is just revolving around the sun, right? Which is sent into the space, which will be just revolving around the sun in the space, and that will be calculating or focusing about your location. That gives the information to the person sitting at the ground surface. Okay, so that's exactly called as GPS, Global Positioning System. Right, so the interaction between the satellite and the person sitting here, or the object which is getting moving here, that is exactly located by a satellite. Right, so what is happening here, the satellite is not coming in contact with the person or the object which we are trying to locate, but what it is doing, it is remotely sensing that. Remotely sensing is nothing but not getting into contact with that object but still getting the information from that object. Right, so for example, there is a thick forest and you as a civil engineer was asked to do some kind of surveying or do a layout mapping over there. So what do you do? Simply you will go into that forest where it's very thick or very dense and so many animals are there. We cannot do so. So in such conditions, what we will do, we will fly in that area. What is meant by flying? Flying is simply, now you can see the latest technology of the photography. What is happening? A drone camera. Drone camera, what is a drone camera? It will just fly in at some height and it is capturing that area, right? In such situations, this remote sensing comes into picture. Okay, remote sensing is nothing but the object and the sensor, whatever is sensing, is not getting in contact. That is what is called as remote sensing. Okay, so we will talk about this in detail. I will give you a best example of a remote sensor. Okay, don't think that only satellite is a remote sensor. Not only satellite, there are so many objects which are remote sensors. For example, your eyes. Are eyes remote sensors? Just think once, are eyes remote sensors? Now I'm seeing my laptop, I'm trying to explain you something, I'm trying to see the part objects which are sitting very nearby to me. Am I getting in contact with that? No, I'm just sensing with my eyes. So eyes are the best examples of remote sensors. But what is the difference between satellite and my eyes? Eyes can only see in a specific wavelength. So you know, everyone know what is an electromagnetic spectrum. You have so many kinds of wavelengths in that, so many ranges in that. In those wavelength or in that electromagnetic spectrum, eyes are only able to see, or eyes will only sense in visible region. Visible region is nothing but your red, blue colors, whatever we have, no? How we see the colors with that wavelength ranges only, we will be able to sense only that wavelength range, which is a visible range. But your satellites or the other optical sensors, whatever are the other remote sensors, they can visualize in all the wavelengths of electromagnetic spectrum. So that's the main difference. Okay. So to make you more understanding or to make you more acquainted to this word remote sensors, I'm giving you an example of eyes. How eyes are sensing everything which is sitting around you. In the same way, your satellites also does the same thing, same job. But what it is doing in different wavelengths. Okay, so that's the kind of understanding of the word remote sensing. So let's see the curriculum first. You can have a look on that. This curriculum is divided into 5 units. First unit basically talks about your satellite based remote sensing. Okay, and we will talk about what are the different platforms are there, what are the different sensors, what are the different satellites, why this remote sensing is important to you, what are the limitations for that remote sensing, what are the kinds of advantages. So it's a kind of introduction to remote sensing. Okay, and in the second unit, it's called as digital image processing. What do we do in this unit 2 is nothing but, so for example, take a camera, take your mobile phone, you will take a photo, right? So what's the output of that photo, or after you click it, what is the output you generally see? It's nothing but a kind of small picture, which can be in a format of a JPEG, or it can be in format of a PNG. So many kinds of formats are there for images. So what is the output? So now when a satellite is capturing an object, the output, whatever is coming outside, is nothing but a digital image. In the same way, how we click a mobile phone, take a photo, how we see the output, in the same way, when the satellite which is sitting in the space is capturing some area, the output, whatever we see, is called as digital image. So now when I click a photo today, what do I do? I see that if the sunlight is not very proper, I do so many kinds of editing. You do increase your color, you increase your brightness, you increase your contrast. You do so many kinds of editing on the photo, whatever you capture, right? In the same way, digital image, whatever we do, you can process that. If you are not able to visualize any objects in that, you use some kinds of techniques or you use some kinds of software, enhance your objects, whichever you are interested in. So that's what is called as digital image processing. The output, whatever you come, you can process that, you can analyze that, you can understand that. All these things come in second unit, okay? Digital image processing. Coming to third unit, as I said, interpretation. So now when I'm not coming in contact with that area, once I click a picture of that, I should be able to understand which is what. So for example, I fly on this, RJKT Basar at some altitude, okay? I allow the drone camera to fly. So everything is got captured. Now I should know where is my civil department, where is my mechanical department, or where is the faculty quarters, or where is the ATM building. I need to locate each area. So I need to interpret something from that image, right? So first thing, I captured it, I got an output, I have processed it. Now I need to interpret, or I need to analyze that area. Then only I will be understanding, or I can perform some kind of analysis on that. So that is your third part, which comes under digital image interpretation. So digital image interpretation. Interpretation is nothing but Now I have captured that image, I got some information. Now I need to understand that area. Why understanding is important? As I gave you an example of a forest, a dense forest is there, you have captured that area. Now I need to understand that area. In order to do some layout or in order to do some kind of survey, I need to understand that area. So that, then comes your analysis part or interpretation part. Okay, so that's your third unit. So next coming, your GPS, as I said, global positioning system. How exactly your route maps are getting displayed? Who is actually doing that? 16 satellites which are sitting in the space, when they combine together, then only the location gets accessed or it will be located. So those satellites, when they get synchronized together, they send a signal back to that location so that a triangulation is being done and a location or the object is getting located. Okay, so that's called as global positioning system. So we will understand how, what is this global positioning system, how this is important, really important in civil engineering or in remote sensing and GIS. So all these things we will have an idea about in the unit 3. Okay, coming to your unit 4, we will get on to GIS, as I said, geographic information system. So now if you just see the technology, upcoming technology in abroad, it's well organized or it's well updated. Everyone are on to this GIS and remote sensing only. India is just developing nowadays. If you see our civil engineering and number of applications. So for example, I will give you a very good example. Let's say you're able to, you are working in a kind of hydrology department, suddenly a dam or suddenly due to a very heavy rainfall, you have experienced a flood. Right. So what you will do as a civil engineer, we need to plan which village should be is at a higher elevation. It should not be getting drowned. You need to understand where water should be diverted first, because if I just lift my gates, what will happen? The water will just go, flow onto the downstream side. It's not a proper way. After lifting the gates, where I need to divert the water is also really important to me as a civil engineer, because I expect that less destruction and less loss of life should happen. So what I will do, I need to plan a flood map. What I should do, which village is at a higher elevation, even if I release the water in that direction also, no village gets drowned, right? So that's my idea of flood mapping. So in order to understand that flood mapping, what I should first know, I need to locate all the villages, right? I need to understand what is the elevation at each area, right? And I need to also understand which village is having more population, which village is very nearby to the dam. All these things I need to know. So there are n number of factors coming into picture. So one is elevation I need to know, I need to have the village map, I need to have the district map. All these things are n number of inputs. I need to know what is the rainfall falling in that area at that point of time, right? All these things I need to know. So when this GIS comes into picture is, you have n number of information to be analyzed. So if it is simply a formula, single formula, if I put into that formula, I will get the output. But it's not single formula. You have n number of factors getting involved into in order to understand the flood mapping. So now what I do, I keep my elevation map into GIS, village map into GIS, I keep my district map. I just say, I will just put all this information into GIS and I will get a one output map, which is called as flood routing or a kind of a flood analysis map. So now by seeing that map, what I will say to that engineer, I will say that, okay, this village, which is very nearby to Basar, is getting drowned first. So you don't send the water first into that village. You send on to the other village, which is very nearby, maybe Navipet or so. You divert this water into that way. So this is how the GIS comes into picture. Okay, so that's one application. So for example, I just wanted to map which are the locations which are having more groundwater in our campus. So what do I do? As a layman, if I just simply go and start digging holes around the campus, it's waste of my time, waste of my energy, waste of my money, right? So rather what I will do, I will analyze what are the factors which are really monitoring or really governing the groundwater. If I make a note of all those factors, I will get some 10 factors. One may be slope, one may be the rainfall, one may be the infiltration, right? One may be the kind of vegetation, one may be the kind of percolation rate happening. All these are n number of factors. So now when I take all these factors and put into GIS, it will be stacked into one single layer and I will get an output which is called as the groundwater potential map, right? So GIS is something, a kind of integrated system where you can put n number of factors or n number of information and you want a single output out of that. That's called as GIS, okay? So in order to stack everything, so now when you keep a bread and jam, no? So one slice when you take, put a jam onto that, the second slice also should sit in the same way. Then only you will get a sandwich outside, right? So if I keep them in improper way or arrange them in the perpendicular direction, I will not get a proper sandwich. So what should happen? One should go and sit on the other one with the same kind of location. So every map, whatever you are doing, should be geographically located. So you might be wondering, what is this geographically located? Geographically located is nothing but, so anytime when you have seen in the railway station, the name will be written, right? So when the name is written, have you ever seen an MSL will be also be written over there as a benchmark, right? In the same way, each location also has a latitude and longitude. Right? So on the globe, each particle or each position is well defined with a latitude and longitude. So now when you're trying to stack different layers together, each of them should have a defined geographic latitude and longitude. Okay? So all these things we'll be learning in when we get on to the course. Okay? So basically your fourth and fifth unit, we will be talking about your what is GIS, what I can do in GIS, why it's really important, what is this map, what is this projection, all these things we will be learning. Okay. Next fifth unit is basically we will be doing some kinds of projects in this. Okay. Projects is nothing but, so you can see here, you will be doing a land use land cover map. So I will say one example to you, land use land cover map. So what is the word meant by land use and land cover? Land use is nothing but, so you can see our entire earth surface, you have some part of water onto that, some part of land onto that. So when I say land, land also has so much forest in that, right? You have a built up area in that, you have an open land, you have a farmland. So land also has been categorized into different kinds of different kinds of categories, right? So what is meant by land use? How the land is getting utilized is called as land use. What is meant by land cover? Land cover is nothing but naturally how that land is getting categorized. Is it a forest land? Is it a dense forest land? It's a scrub land? It's an open land? So these are coming as land cover. If this cover you're trying to utilize into a built up area or you're doing some kinds of plotting, it's called as land use. Okay, so that's the difference between land use and land cover. How the land is getting used is called as land use. How it's naturally present in that way, if you leave it, it is called as land cover. So for example, if someone comes and asks you as a civil engineer, can you say how much urbanization or how much land use, land cover has been utilized in Basar area since 20 years. Someone has asked you how much Basar got developed since 20 years in terms of urbanization. So in terms of urbanization means you might be understanding what is urbanization. It is nothing but how many buildings have come into picture or how well it is getting developed. Right, how many factories have come, how many kinds of, what do you say, built up area has been generated. If someone comes and asks you a question, what you will do? You will simply do the survey. Presently you can do the survey. Old survey, who is going to give you the reports or how you will calculate the urbanization? Now you simply go, you take your theodolite or your total total station instrument, go to each area, do that. We cannot do that. It's a very tedious job. You cannot say, I will start my survey today. I will be giving the report in the coming months or coming years. Because it's a very tedious job. I cannot take my each instrument into each area and measure how much urbanization has been done. Rather, you can use remote sensing and GIS. How I can use remote sensing and GIS? Simply what I will do. Now someone asked me 20 years data. So what you will do, some satellites which are already there in the space have been collected the information long back. So 20 years from now, 2000, some satellite has collected the information of BASIR. It is already stacked in remote sensing agency. If you see the remote sensing agencies, there are two agencies. ISRO is one thing, and the second one, which is located in Hyderabad, National Remote Sensing Agency. What that agency will do is, whatever the satellite is sitting in the space, when it sends the signals down into the ground station, they will collect all the information. They will stack it in CDs, or they are stacked in a well-defined information. So whoever wants that information, at an accuracy, they can purchase it, or some things are freely available also to the people. Okay, so information is well stacked. So in 2000 year, that satellite which has collected the information is there with the National Remote Sensing Agency. What I will do, I will purchase that data. And anyway, some satellites are already there in 2020. They are already going and just revolving around in the space. So already today's data is also getting captured. So I have the past 20 years back data with me. Now today's data is also available with me. Now I will put them into the GIS and I try to analyze how much land use and land cover has been done. Earlier 20 years back, if you see, our campus is also not there. But today it is there. What has happened? Some land cover is got converted into a built up area. Some land got utilized. So that's urbanization, right? 20 years back only temple was there. So that's only the built up area. But now if you see 20 years now, so much urbanization has been done. I can talk in terms of percentage, maybe 20% urbanization, 30% urbanization, or I can talk in terms of area calculation, volume calculation. So many things I can talk in terms of land use and land cover, which I cannot do physically. I can do, but it is time constrained. If I just want the result to be seen in 1 or 2 days, I can do it. And what am I doing? I'm just sitting at my place, at my table itself, and I'm trying to do. I'm not going anywhere outside. But one thing I can say, that remote sensing and GIS gives you 90% result. But the last 10% we need to verify, because you understand, if a robo is there, an instrument or a robo is there, if you give some input to that, it will give some output to you. But you as a person, you should understand whether that output is correct or not. So whenever we are trying to work digitally, right, work digitally, understand with the software, what you should do is 90% result is given by the software. But my job as a person, what I should do, 10% I need to work on that and see whether the software is giving me the right output or not. So a ground verification is really important once the software publishes your result. When the software publishes your result, that's not the end. When that end comes into picture, whenever you cross-verify with the ground truth, because I'm nowhere going onto the ground. So who will say that it's wrong or right? So when I take this result, go on to the ground, analyze it, really it's correct or not, when I cross-check it, then only I can publish my result. Okay, so there are so many kinds of applications. So slowly we will try to understand what is this remote sensing, what is this GIS, how these two got integrated. So now how these two got integrated in land use and land cover, I took a remote sensing satellite image, I brought them into this GIS, and then have given you some change about land use and land cover. So both of them, I together integrated them, and then I have given to you. Right? So this is how an integration happens. So slowly, one by one, when I try to, say unit by unit or step by step, then you will try to understand. So you might be having a doubt why remote sensing is kept in a very two units. See, once when you're trying to utilize something, you should understand the background of that also. So as I said, the word itself, remote sensing. Sensing an object without getting in contact with that is called as remote sensing. For example, you have a TV at your home, you have a remote for that. So remote, will that remote go and touch the TV? No. It is very far away from the TV, and wherever, and now if you see the latest technology, in whichever room are you sitting, you can operate your remote. It's not that you need to point that TV. from any direction it's getting operated. So that's a remote sensor. What that remote is doing, it's having a kind of batteries which actually operate wherever you are. It's not getting in contact with it. I gave you an example of our eyes. Eyes are the best remote sensors. What are they doing? I'm not getting in contact, but still I'm visualizing the object. I'm able to see a chair here. I'm able to see a laptop here. Am I getting in contact with that? No. Without getting in contact with the object, we are trying to sense. When I say sense, is nothing but I'm trying to understand the characteristic properties of the object. Okay. So, but how? Which energy is really responsible, or how this sensing is happening, we should understand. Okay. The best remote sensor in mammals, or all of you know bat. Have you ever seen bat? Bat will be having a very big wings, and it will be just flying in the sky at a very heights. Okay. So that's a very good, what do you say, remote sensor. What's the difference between our eyes and that bat eyes are nothing but our eyes can only capture in visible region. We can only see that visible region. So how are we able to see? When sunlight is just falling onto our, what do you say, eyes, we are only able to capture that, what do you say, the visible light reflection. Whatever color is there, that color you are able to visualize. Okay, that's how we are able to see. How that bat will be able to see is, bat will be able to see not only in that visible region, but also in the other regions. So you can see here, remote sensing is a technology of acquiring the information of the earth's surface without getting in contact with it. Okay, so now when someone asks you what is remote sensing, remote sensing is nothing but acquiring, getting the information of the object, whichever you are interested, without getting in contact with that, is called as remote sensing. So you can see here, eyes. Eyes are the best remote sensor. You get the information, you watch some kind of, just have a look onto the nature, you are able to see that's a hill, there is a tree, there is a sky. How are you trying to differentiate? Right? So we are not getting in contact with that object, but still we are able to acquire the information of that object. That's called as remote sensing. Okay, you can see the picture of the bat here. Bat are the best remote sensors which can see in a very high wavelength range. Human eyes can only limit to that visible region, but bat can even visualize in the other wavelength ranges also. Okay, so what has been done here? I'm saying acquiring information, collecting information, but how is that been happening? Which energy is really important for this capture is nothing but some kind of energy, let's say a solar energy. There are two kinds of energy. One is your passive energy, one is active energy. Okay, we will see one by one. Okay, so this is done by sensing and recording reflected or emitted energy, processing, analyzing and applying the information. So there are so many terms which I have introduced to you. First thing, sensing. Sensing means I am just sensing that but not getting in contact. After that, what I should do, I need to record that. Whatever I'm trying to sense that, I need to record that, store that, after that analyze that or interpret that, then only I will get the information of that object. Okay, so remote sensing, when someone asks you, you should say we are not getting in contact with that. There are so many steps in that. First, you need to sense. Next, you need to collect the information, record the information. You need to stack the information, because let's say 2020, I'm sitting now and I wanted to see some 20 years back data, how it's there or what is there in that. So if it is not properly stacked or properly stored, I will not be able to access it later. So while collecting itself, I need to stack that information very properly. Okay, so what am I doing here? You need to see the next slide, then you will understand very nicely. A very quick picture which makes you understand what is a remote sensing. Okay, so you can see this picture here. You have your sun on the right hand corner. You can see a sun over here. Okay, so what is happening? Sunlight is just falling onto the earth's surface. On earth surface, what are the different kinds of objects which are present? You can see so many buildings are there, small houses are there, roads are there, bare soil, your open soil, grass is there, water body is there, forest is there. There's so many kinds of objects which are there on the earth's surface. some are land use, some are land cover, right? And solar energy is just falling onto the earth surface. What is happening when energy is just getting focused onto an object? What happens? Based upon the properties of the object, reflection happens, transmission happens, right? So understand these words, reflection, transmission, right? When solar energy is getting instant on an object, reflection will be possible and transmission will be possible. What is this reflection? What is this transmission? Take a white body. All of you understand by a white body and a black body? Black body, whatever the solar radiation falls onto that, it absorbs all the radiation and only reflects some part of radiation, right? So when solar radiation is falling onto the object, it absorbs some energy and reflects some energy. Absorption is called as a kind of transmission. Transmission means from one body, it is going inside, right? It's absorbing some energy and reflecting the energy. So now, how the satellite will sense that object? By using the reflected energy. So you can see the picture here. So what is happening when the solar radiation has fallen onto this built-up area? Some energy is getting absorbed and some energy gets reflected. So you may have a question, how much is the percentage? It depends upon the object sitting there. Okay, so if a white body is sitting there, what will happen? Less transmission, less absorption happens. It will only reflect more amount, right? So in such kind of body, more reflection is happening. If a black body is sitting, more absorption happens. It depends upon the characteristic properties of the object where this solar radiation is falling. But some part, let's say 100% of solar energy is falling onto my black body, what will happen? 90% gets absorbed and only 10% gets reflected. So that 10%, whatever is getting reflected, that will be captured by my satellite. So satellite, which energy is really responsible for the sensing? Reflected back energy. Whatever the reflection is happening from that body, when that is going into the space, that satellite captures that energy and says that what really is the object sitting over there. So that's what is called as satellite based remote sensing. So by now you understood the word remote sensing, sensing an object remotely. What is satellite based remote sensing? Satellite based remote sensing is nothing but sensing an object remotely using a satellite. Okay. What is the source of energy? Source of energy is nothing but the reflected solar energy. Reflected solar energy is captured by the satellite and internally it has something, a conversion is there, which exactly gets converted digitally and says that, okay, there is a road sitting there, there is a soil sitting there is a built up area sitting there. It will categorize into that way. Okay, so what's really the source of energy which the satellite uses is your reflected solar energy. So when this reflected solar energy is captured by the satellite, then a digital image will be coming outside. You need to store the digital image, you need to analyze that image and then say some information. Okay, sensing is nothing but giving some information. How are we giving? Remotely we are giving. What the satellite is doing, which energy? It's not the solar energy, it's the reflected solar energy. Okay, so artificially also you can produce this kind of reflected solar energy. So as I said, there is passive remote sensing, there is active remote sensing. What is the difference between passive and active? Passive just utilizes your reflected back solar energy. What this active does is artificially you produce that reflected solar energy and then you capture that. So for example, at night time you want to capture any kind of information, solar energy will not be there. In such cases, what you should do, you need to provide artificially some reflected energy. Okay, so that's what is called as active remote sensing, active sensors, not a kind of passive sensor. Passive is nothing but it's there in that time scale only, but active, whenever you want, you can do. Solar radiation is only available from morning sunrise to evening sunset. In that range, you can collect the information. there may be some kinds of objects which you really wanted to collect in other also, right? Other time, or you wanted to see that in different time scale, different what do you say, seasons, so many things you wanted to do, then you can go for active remote sensing. Today, what's the next slide? So you can see here a small kind of understanding. It's not only with a satellite, as I said, you a drone camera. So what's the difference between a drone camera and a person sitting and capturing a photo? So how is it different? So when a photographer comes and captures, he is standing at a single position. He is taking only in that frame wherever you stand. So that's how the photography generally used to be at least 5 years or 10 years back. But now if you see the kind of any kinds of occasions or some kinds of celebrations, what are they doing? Persons are simply standing and clicking. At the same time, aerial photography has also come into picture. What is this aerial photography? Simply a camera is moving at a very high elevation than you, and it's capturing the overall view, right? So more information is getting collected when you are just flying at some height. So sitting at some location, capturing only that frame is getting captured. If you just move, the other frame comes into picture. But when you're trying to fly, more information is getting collected, right? So that's the example of your remote sensing platforms. If you see, earlier also we used to have how people used to capture the images, aerial television, how that, if you see the olden photography also, the camera used to sit in a kind of parachute and it used to be captured. Photos used to be captured. So that's how the aerial photography has come into picture. So step by step, if you see, aerial television, which is nothing but the camera is fixed in that aeroplane. Next, aerial photography, the cameras itself are fixed into that, drone, and it's flying at a very high altitude. You can see the altitude change also. 0.3 kilometers, 3.5 kilometers. Now, if you see the satellite optical sensors, it's sitting at 700 to 900 kilometers, even thousands also you will be having. We will talk about these satellites. Next coming, space shuttles. Space shuttles are nothing but they are defined for some kind of application. For example, if you see IIT Roorkee has their own space shuttle. They have their own satellite at some altitude from their campus. It gives the information about the entire campus, or it will be anyways revolving, so it collects the information. They have the defined kinds of wavelength ranges, or you have some specific characteristics defined, that is called as your space shuttle. Next, airborne SAR. Airborne SAR is nothing but, SAR is nothing but you will work on a different wavelengths, okay? So that also you have some kinds of altitudes. So now, remote sensing, your phone is a remote sensor, your eyes are remote sensor. At what altitude you are working actually changes the, the terminology, okay? Drone camera, fixed camera, you understand the difference in the same way. This satellite, that is the difference, okay?
So that's about the discussion what we had today about the kinds of curriculum what we have seen, and we got a brief overview about what is this course, and we have also started with what is exactly the remote sensors, and what is this technology happening inside this remote sensing, and we have also understood a brief overview about the platforms which are there in the remote sensors. So let's stop our discussion here, and we will see it in the next class.